aware of a block for it to go away and for you to become quite clear about it. Loretta, you told me something beautiful that made me cry over breakfast. You didn't make me cry. I cried in reaction to you telling the story. But I think it's a beautiful example of a block you didn't know you had that you became aware of. Do you feel comfortable sharing that with the group?
Sure. After doing the course for about 3 weeks, just upon reflection, I started to question how I'd been living my life. And I likened it to being like a director of a play. So all those years whenever there was a special event, I was so busy making sure that, you know, everything was just perfect, do all the organising, make sure, you know, the props, the costumes, so that everybody in the play is set and has a good time. And I likened that to my family and a lot of, you know, special events. So I felt like the director. So when the event was happening or unfolding, I was like on the outside, just looking in, not in the play. And that's when I decided I don't want to live my life like that, you know, anymore. I actually want to be part of it. I want to be in the play, on the stage, not just sitting on the outer looking in. So, yeah.
Thank you so much, Loretta. It's such a beautiful example because Loretta wasn't aware she was living her life like that. So how could she change it without any awareness? And she didn't have to do anything incredible about it. She just had to notice it. And now that she has that awareness of it, she's going to let it go. And she's going to actually submerge herself into the experience of the event and be in it rather than be on the outside of it, making sure that everybody else is experiencing the event. So it made me tearful for Loretta, but also for myself. I could really resonate with that. That I've done a lot of that in my life as well, and perhaps some of you have done that as well. So this life force is coming through us continuously, and we can tap into it and have moments of noticing it. Yesterday when we were talking about ways to raise our awareness, which just means become more aware, we talked about yoga and meditation because we've had the yoga session yesterday and now we've had a meditation session this morning. But for some of you, that may not be giving you that feeling of awareness yet because you're practicing and you might be going through those stages where in fact the mind just gets busier, so you're not actually feeling that connection. But one of the things that Tanya said that increases her feeling of connection and level of awareness is to feel love. So who has experienced that when you feel love deeply, it feels different to when you're not feeling love deeply? How would you describe, would anybody feel comfortable describing when you just think about someone you love or you look at somebody that you love and you feel love deeply? Can anyone explain that experience? There may not be any words for it, but does anyone want to have a go?
Kind of a sense of euphoria, like I'm with you.
That euphoria, yeah. That almost expansive feeling. The way that I describe it is that I don't feel like I'm inside my body, I feel expanded outside of my body. So I feel a oneness. I get it often when I'm driving in the car and I'm out in the countryside and I can see the clouds in the sky and the trees and the hills and the grass, and I'm just in awe of it. And I don't think for a while. I'm just in awe of what I see, and I feel like I become part of it. And I feel euphoric. I feel outside of my body. And in fact, we were laughing about this the other night because one day this happened to me. So I had two children very close together. So I had Anna, and then when she was 4 months old, I got pregnant with Kiara. Both of them accidentally, not mistakes, they're beautiful, but both accidentally. I know how it happened. and then I said, that's it, I'm done. Oh my God, I'm done. You know, that was so busy. And then I was out in the Barossa Valley driving to a work appointment, and I was having this euphoric experience where I blended with my environment. And I had this vision, I'm getting goosebumps, of like a 20-year-old boy, and I knew that he needed to be my son. And so I've come back and I've told Damien, you know, like this, like I am now, you know, and if you know my husband, I'm married a weirdo. And I said, oh, going to have another baby? And he goes, what? And so anyway, we did. But he tells the story. So anyway, you know, Tracy was smoking drugs one day. She went to the Barossa for a few cones. But I didn't. But that's the experience that I feel when the life force is flowing through me. And I also feel it when I'm doing this. Because this is my path and this is my calling and I am actually following my soul's path, I feel very, very connected to Source and I feel that life force is flowing through me. Mm-hmm. And I sometimes feel like the words that come out of my mouth are channeled from that life force rather than me thinking about what I'm going to say next, because often it surprises me what I say. So, Marika, you're very, very creative. When you're designing, how does it feel for you?
I guess it's a bit like a form of meditation in that I just am lost when I'm in it. I don't think any of the negative thoughts that I'm having in a day-to-day sort of sense or rehashing things in my head. I'm just in the moment, I guess. And I'm not distracted by anything. I'm just totally focused. Yeah, I guess that's my form of bliss.
Yeah. And we all have this. This is the discovery as we lead from today into this afternoon that can come as you start to let go. So what did you need to let go of, Marika, to allow yourself to spend more time in your bliss?
Other work. So other commitments. A fear of failure, that what I was doing, and I'm still working towards that, getting over what other people think of what you're doing, what you're creating, comparison, yeah, so I'm still working towards it, but yeah.
That's a perfect summary. Yeah, and it's really what I went through as well, you know, being very successful in the network marketing business, having a physiotherapy business that is well respected for 20 years, earning a great stream of income from both of those. For me to let go of those things and walk away from them, it was like leaping from a very tall building without a parachute. And, you know, this is a person that would not jump out of the plane if it works. So, but when you do, and when you follow your soul's calling, everything falls into place to help you land. And that is what I've experienced, but it didn't mean that I wasn't afraid to do it. So, and it doesn't have to be a big leap, it's just that decision to let go of those things that are stopping you from what you really want to do. So the blocks that we have that block the life force, the first one I want to talk about is attachment. So when we set a goal, sometimes we can get very attached to it. And what we're saying to the life force is, I won't be happy until that thing comes about. And when you're attached to that, you will never be happy. You actually have to have that innate happiness first to allow that to show up. So another way to talk about life force is frequency. So the life force is the highest level of frequency that you can tap into, and it's equivalent to love. And that's why I use the example of feeling that deep emotion of love so that you can have a feel of what that frequency is like. So when you're doing your passion, whether it's creation or whatever it may be, it might be gardening, whatever really makes your heart sing, it puts you on that highest frequency. The lowest frequency you can be on is fear. So this is why often the juggle to let go is to let go of the fear so that you can move to that frequency of love. So the attachment to what's coming to you, the thing that you want, is blocking it from coming to you. So when you are loving what you want, let's use the example of more money, because that'll make lots of people feel uncomfortable. Because a lot of people don't like to talk about money because of all sorts of things, but basically the way you've been conditioned, money is just energy, just like I'm energy, just like your energy. So it's not scary, it's not evil. I grew up with the belief that it was evil because I grew up in the church and we were to give it all away, and the people that had a lot of money were crooks. So that's what I was taught. And also I learnt very, very firsthand that if you have a lot of money, people won't like you. So when I was in Year 10 at Port Lincoln High School, I was sitting on a pipe for some reason, a great big water pipe, near the oval with my friends, and a girl came over to me and roundhoused me in the face, straight into my nose, and said, "Rich bitch." And I went, "Oh my God, it really hurts to be rich." It was so painful. And of course, I wasn't rich, I was 15, but you could see my parents' home from the school. And so, you know, I went, okay, I need to lay low, I need to be average, because that's really painful. So in lots of different ways, we can learn to fear money. So let's say that you've admitted to yourself, yeah, a little bit more abundance would be nice, and you need to be on the frequency of someone who is abundant. But instead, you're like, oh my God, this bill, how am I going to pay this bill? So you've said you want money, but you're on the frequency of fear. So you cannot attract the flow of that energy, money, which is on the frequency of abundance and feeling abundant. So when you feel abundant, you become abundant. So can you see the difference? So the example that Kathy shared yesterday is that her one of her things that she wanted was more freedom. And then when she went to write the opposite, she was like, more freedom. It's a choice. I am freedom. I am free. And you can start to look at all the freedom that you do have. You know, if we compare living in Australia in comparison to living in North Korea, they don't have any freedom. They are brainwashed. They're not allowed to think their own thoughts. They have to just toe the line. We have complete freedom. We have complete choice. But often we don't believe that we do. So when you want to attract something into your life, you need to let go of the blocks that are blocking you from being on the frequency of the life that you want to live. So I just want you to reflect on that and just write down the thing that perhaps is most important to you at the moment to have more of in your life. And just ask yourself, why aren't I on that frequency? What would it take for me to feel like that as if it was already true? So have a little think and just write down what comes up for you. Yeah, so think about what you want and think about the fact that you don't have it, and then feel what it would feel like to have it already. Imagine what you would feel like if you had the life that you want in whatever area it is. So let's use a relationship, for example. So you might be in a relationship at the moment that isn't working. You know, you're at each other, you know, you bicker or you have fights or there's just some sort of thing going on between you. But what you really want is a relationship that's free and easy and you just feel comfortable around them and you can be yourself and you can speak your truth. And even if you don't agree, you can just talk about it. Whatever you would like to see in that relationship, how would you feel if that was already true? How would that feel for you right now? What would you feel like? And do you feel like that now? And it will make you more aware of how you're feeling now about certain situations, and it will make you understand why you're stuck in that situation. Because while you keep feeling that way, you continually recreate the situation.
So, I've got massive block right now. I live with my mum, who's got nearly upset with Alzheimer's, and she's now lived with me for 3 years, so she was only just diagnosed. But I'm crazy enough to think I can help, so I actually, you know, I knew there was something wrong, but I didn't want to believe it. I just kept doing what I was doing, but I was very, very frustrated, and I didn't want to become her. And I, even just now, I'm sitting here, and I'm like, forgetting this, I'm forgetting that, you know. I'm so frightened of becoming like her that I'm...
So are you now that you've moved, are you going to continue to live with her?
Yeah.
Okay. So the first thing that I want you to do is to ask yourself, why do I choose to live with my mum? And and remember that it's a choice. I know part of you, because I can see the fear in your face, tells you that you don't have a choice. But I've been through the same experience. I started with my dad living with me, and I made a choice for the happiness of my family and myself and in his best interests to create an environment for him where he could be with people. And I'm not telling you to do this. I'm asking you to question why you've made that choice. You may keep the choice. We really need tissues. I knew today we would need tissues. We've got napkins. We're all exfoliating our faces today. So just really be honest. It's okay to be honest with yourself about why you make that choice without any judgment, and it's a process. And part of letting go does make you cry, because it's a release, and it's good to cry because you're actually going to let, that's how you let it go. And if you do choose to continue to live with your mum, then you will have a different experience of living with your mum, because you'll know why you're doing it, and you'll honestly want to do it for reasons that are good for you. And this is one of the most difficult things to get really comfortable with as you get to know yourself. And people pleasers always put everybody else first, and we're taught to do that, and we feel like we're really good people because we do that, and it's actually looked up upon. And certainly I spent my whole life doing that as well. But the problem with that is what we're really doing is pushing down resentment. We're pretending to ourselves it's okay, and it's not. So we keep doing it because we want to be a good person. But ultimately, it's energy. Resentment is energy, and the person you're resenting can feel the energy as well anyway. No matter how nice you are on the surface and how loving you are in your words, ultimately the energy is, this is awkward. I was lucky enough that my dad was lucid enough to say, this is not right. This is not right for your family. I feel like a burden. It was the best thing he could have said to me, because he was right. He did feel like a burden being in our family, even though everyone was nice to each other and we were just treating him like part of the family, and there was no arguments. It was all fine. He's very old school and throws a few spanners in the conversations. Anna brought her boyfriend over, and he met him for the first time, and he goes, well, you're a bit of a prick. Excellent. My top and my dad. we went along with that. We allowed that behaviour, you know, and understand that's where it comes from. But he was able to at least verbalise how he was feeling. And I guess because he's so blunt, that's why he could. So just give yourself some space around really thinking about that.
I think I have a little bit. I did resent it. I've resented mum for such a long time because she's lived in such an abusive relationship, and it's filtered through our family. I've been lucky enough to get out of it. Sorry, Daniel becomes abusive. I've got almost but so when she was diagnosed, all that resentment went away, and I actually thought, you know what, I really have attracted this because I'm so into, you know, standing up for women and, you know, bullying and, I feel like that resentment's gone. I'm still here going, what does it all mean? How do I, you know, put it all together, and what does it all mean? And I know exactly what he's saying, but I don't feel like somewhere else.
And that's okay. That's okay. Accept that. But look at all the reasons why you're looking after her, and they need to be for you, as well as it's the right thing to do, as well as she's my mum, as well as I love my mum. There needs to be reasons for you that you're doing. So, for example, you might decide, I choose to live with my mum because it demonstrates to me who I really am. And then when you ever start to feel overwhelmed or agitated by what's going on in that relationship, you remind yourself, I choose this because it allows me to demonstrate who I really am. And then you describe that, I am giving, I am generous, I am loving, you know, and I love without conditions. Do you mind turning the light on, please? It's a little bit dark or something. Yeah, so does that help so that you really tap into that? I also want to come back to what you said, what does it all mean? It means the meaning that you give it. So always assign a meaning to anything that's going on. Sometimes what we think about the soul's path is that we have no idea what's going on. Whereas if you choose your path, then you go, this is all part of my path. So you're making the selection rather than being at the whim of the gods or the universe or the stars or the moon or all those things that we can then blame for our circumstances, or we can go, I don't know what this means. So give it meaning by choosing the path that you're on. So call yourself, you know, the carer of your mum. You've decided to take on that role and you've got your own meaning behind it if you choose to do that.
I think even on, you know, a soul level, just what you're saying, I feel like we are coming from such a strength for so many years, and we've had it, you know, she's always kind of looked up to me, and, you know, it's all wonderful, but I have not looked at her in the same way, which is not a nice thing to say about your mum, and I love her, but, yeah, I've really not liked her at times. But I feel like where we're at now, was this how it was always meant to be? If I just accepted who she was before, and I didn't have, you know, if I didn't let her into, or let that anger into my life before, maybe we would have got there. Do you know what I'm saying? I feel
it's
like
very similar. Anita, do you mind me comparing?
No,
are you sure? Because I won't tell you.
Yeah, no.
It's a very similar story. So it's okay. Crying is allowed because we've got really rough tissues. You're all going to be glowing. I've got to tell you, this is a beauty class. So sometimes, if you remember that your mum is a soul as well, so her soul story was to be a victim, to go through this and to get stuck in that victim life. And her opportunity to break free of that was to bring a shining light into her family. And you're that shining light, and your sister. So you've come into her life to wake her up, but that's all you can do is shine your light. This is where the attachment comes in. When we serve others, sometimes we're attached to them being healed. When I started the Soul Pleaser course, I had to let go of the results anyone was going to have, even though it was the reason I was doing it. I wrote the Soul Pleaser course to transform people's lives, but if I was attached to them transforming, that's outside of my control. It's up to the person who does the course what they do with it. And when you give love to your mum unconditionally, she can slam it in your face and you still let it go, because you don't give it to get any reaction or any response or any transformation. And so sometimes our parents go to the grave without transformation, and it's not our fault.
And that's what I think I've been really stuck on. I'm so, even with my sister.
Around the word namaste. So do you know when we say namaste, when we say that? At the end of the yoga class. Does anyone know what namaste means?
From my heart, myself to yourself.
Yeah, that's it's one translation. Had it?
Greeting. You can do it as a greeting as
yes.
Well.
So it's that old Indian language, Sanskrit. And the most beautiful translation of the word namaste I found in that shop. Oh my god, when you come up to something else, I need to take you to that shop. It's an amazing shop. So, like, it's a vegan cafe and it has all these beautiful gifts and crystals, and it's just like heaven, and I can't get a bit in there and out there without buying something. But anyway, so I bought this card. And it's just like the most beautiful translation of the word namaste, what I found. And it says, I honor the place in you in which the entire universe dwells. I honor the place in you which is of love, of truth, of light, and of peace. When you are in that place in you, and I'm in that place in me,